Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
All right, good evening, everybody. Let's come to order. This is the January 16th, 2018 meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I'm Chair Amy Gailey, and this is Eddie Boswell, and Bob Bird, and Bill Lashley, and Tim Sutton's not with us. So, if you care to, please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for allowing us to be here tonight. We pray that your protection would be over us as snow maybe starts to fall this evening, and that you would keep people safe and warm. And we pray, Lord, for the people who work on the power lines and who have extra duties and extra jobs when there's bad weather, that you would be with them and help them to do a good job. We also pray for our first responders and those in our military, that you would reward them, Lord, for their service and their fortitude. And lastly, Lord, we pray for wisdom for this new year, that you would guide us as we make decisions and help us to do what's right. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Please join me for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, before we get to the public speakers tonight, we have a thing that we're doing this year. We have a lot of things on our plate to take a look at over the course of 2018. We're going to have quite a few public hearings. We're going to have some interesting things that come up. And so I have chosen to, at the beginning of each meeting, review our public comment policy, as well as the decorum of the audience rules for this commission. I want to stress that this is not in response to anybody who signed up to speak, or it's not a reaction to anything that's happened in the past. This is just a review for the future, so that everybody knows what's expected. And these rules are available on our county website, so that members of the public can take a look at them at their leisure. So the comment period is limited to a maximum of 30 minutes, and I'm not reading the whole thing word for word. I'm just hitting the high points here. Then we're going to have a commissioner's response period immediately following the public comment period, and this is a point of response from the commissioners to respond to comments that have been made. It's not to debate with the public. Each person desiring to speak shall have 3 minutes to make their remarks. There is no more than 3 speakers on any one topic per meeting. If you have several people who want to speak about the same thing, then it's recommended that you choose one person to speak for all of you. Speakers shall address the board from the lectern at the front of the room, and please begin remarks by stating their name and address. If you need accommodation for a disabling condition, of course, please just let us know, and we are more than happy to do the best we can to accommodate you. The public comment is not intended to require the Board of Commissioners to answer any impromptu questions. Speakers will please address all comments to the commissioners as a whole and not to individual commissioners. Discussions between speakers and members of the audience are not permitted. Speakers shall be courteous in their language and presentation. Speakers shall not discuss any of the following: matters which concern the candidacy of any person seeking public office, matters which are the subject to public hearings, and matters which are closed session matters. Speakers should not engage in personal attacks that, by irrelevance, duration, or tone, may threaten or perceive to threaten the orderly and fair progress of the discussion. And our public comment policy was most recently revised in September of 2014. As far as the decorum of the audience, it's necessary that members of the audience, in order to efficiently transact public business, members of the audience demonstrate an appropriate decorum and respect for the board and speakers. To this end, audience members shall conduct themselves as follows. Please refrain from making unsolicited comments during the meeting. During speakers from the floor or debate by the board, audience members shall refrain from conduct which disrupts the proceeding. This conduct may include, but is not limited to, cheers, hissing, booing, clapping, cursing, or any other conduct which disturbs the proceedings. Audience members shall please silence all cell phones and other electronic devices while attending the meeting. That being stated, the first person we have signed up to comment tonight is Mr. Anthony Pierce. He will come.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Hello to the commissioners and everybody present. My name is Anthony Pierce. My address is 2009 Atlas Drive over in Hall River by mailing, should I say, over in the Melville Township is what I would consider. But first, thank you for the opportunity to be able to stand before you. In the interest of time and also being respectful of the rules and regulations associated with public speaking comments, I'll get right to the point and try to expedite this as quickly as possible, looking at the time. So I want to just comment surrounding the ongoing discussion of tabling the activity of the sale of the Canodal Clinic. I don't know if this is a great thing or not, but I like to follow the meetings. I've been following them over the last few months, so I've noticed that it's been in discussion almost every meeting, at least for a couple minutes or so, but we haven't resolved this issue at this point, even though we have an active bid on the table. It's been tabled. So just to recap for those that may not be familiar, but the property was donated to the county, so it didn't cost us anything to purchase the property. There hasn't been any use of that building, or in theory, it's really a liability versus an asset if it's not being used, because it's costing to sit still, in my humble opinion. It was brought to the fore during the open bidding process, you know, as customary. Everyone in the entire county and surrounding areas had the ability to bid on the property, but it resulted in one person returning the bid. For whatever reason, it was tabled to various comments from the commissioners and then extended even outside of that to do what I would call a fit for use analysis by an exterior team, which is, you know, I think is a good thing. However, what I wanted to comment on is just the public perception. The public perception, looking at this issue being ongoing over time, you know, so my goal is just to provide a little insight to how the public may perceive what has actually transpired over the last few months surrounding that particular case. So back when I was in public service, I remember some of the tenets were, you know, we're service oriented, meaning we cater to the needs of the public, we have to have compassion, and the goal was always to do what's best for the community, despite what decisions we had to make, but it's never been about money. So when I completed the Alamance County Academy, I got a chance to meet some awesome people that were leaders in the county departments that exhibited those competencies and those behaviors that I remember back when I was there, which was great. Some of them, I think they used the term that they did things sweat equity. And I'm like, oh, wow, that's just amazing, because you have that compassion, that heart to drive to serve the community. So as I expedite, wow, that was quick. So let me fast forward to get to the end. So I know we want to table things to try to do the fit for use analysis, but I feel that this is probably one that in the interest of making sure we're creating the right behavior, that we might want to remove and actually move forward on that particular piece and allow the other county buildings to go through that process, because I feel like what we're doing is we're dragging it along, and this is going to be, when I did the research, an excellent service that is not currently being offered by the county. So I think it would be an asset versus a liability. And if we can take, if you would consider making an exception to that one particular property so that she can probably move forward. And I admit, I don't know, I never met her. I just looked up the company itself and kind of went from there. So I'll leave it there and save my last page for another time. Are there any questions for me or anything? Thank you.
Thank you so much. We'll make comments at the end after all the public speakers. The commissioners, excuse me, have an opportunity to comment. It does give me opportunity to say one thing that we do, speakers have the opportunity to bring your comments and leave them with the clerk so that, and I don't know how many people are aware of that, and so then it becomes part of the public record. So that's a good thing to know about. All right, Mr. Paul Newberry.
Hi, I'm Paul Newberry, 3705 Osceola Road in Elon, North Carolina. I was here last month talking about Republic Waste. First of all, I'd like to thank the board for listening and being attentive and asking good questions. I'd like to thank the county manager. He did exactly what he said he was going to do. He talked to the landfill man. He called me and he told me that. The landfill man called me and told me he was going to talk to Republic Waste. A man by the name of Tony, and I'm sorry I don't know his last name, he did call me. We had a long and frank discussion as I drove home from Greensboro. And he said that they were working to try to improve the service. Now, let's fast forward to the results. As you know, New Year's Day was a Monday, so our trash would be pushed to Friday. And if you remember that week, we had a little bit of snow here in Graham, about 2 inches, kind of surprised some people, including myself, got caught out in it. But up where I live, we didn't have any snow. So on Friday when I got home, my trash wasn't picked up. So I picked up my cell phone. Thankfully, Tony gave me his cell phone number, and I called him. And he said he'd check in and call me back, and he did. And he told me that they were still picking up, and if it didn't get picked up by today, it'd be picked up on Saturday. Well, on Saturday morning, I said, okay, if it's not picked up by noon, I'll call you back. He said, no, no, no. If it's not picked up by 10, call me back. 10 o'clock, I called him back. He said, oh, goodness gracious. So, long story short, I sat there and waited all day long for my garbage to be picked up. And, you know, when I call, I'm not calling for me. I'm calling for everybody on our street. Well, about 3 o'clock, I went out to get my mail, and I thought, my trash can's been moved. Guess what? They sent somebody out to pick up my trash can. That's it. Now, that's oil in the squeaky wheel, in my opinion, and that's not acceptable. Later on, my neighbor said, well, she got this message, and I'd like to play it for you from Republic Waste.
3:21 p.m. Hello, this is Republic Services, your trash and recycle provider, with a service update. Due to road conditions, some routes have been suspended. Any customers not serviced by the end of the day tomorrow, January 6, 2018, will be serviced on their regular scheduled service day, and 2 weeks of materials will be recovered at that time. If you have any questions, you can give us a call at 336.
That's not acceptable. If you're not going to pick up on Friday, which is the day you're supposed to, get your people out of bed and have them pick up on Saturday. If they can't pick up on Saturday, why don't you start the route on Monday with what you didn't pick up on last
Absolutely
week?
True. Absolutely true.
So, give me one more second. I happened to talk to a coworker today that lives in Stokesdale in Guilford County. And guess what? They're having the same issue with Republic Waste. So I don't know what's going on with Public Waste, but they're not meeting anybody's needs in this area. I'd like to thank you.
When does their contract run out?
June 30th of this year. And in fact, we're having a meeting tomorrow with Republic Waste leadership here at the county office building, weather permitting. I think they have staff coming from all over the place to meet with us about this very issue. We've received numerous complaints about Republic service lately. And I do want to say thank you to the landfill staff. I've sent every complaint or question that I've gotten to them, and they have been very prompt in getting back with the property owners, and I think trying to encourage Republic to get back with them too. So I think the chair, myself, and county attorney, we're all meeting with their staff tomorrow.
Make sure they see the video of this gentleman's presentation.
Indeed.
So they just picked your
just mine. That's it. I didn't even think they got mine because I could just look out the street. I can't see my can from my house because of the way my driveway is facing. But I can see everybody else's, and the cans are open. It's trashed on top. They only give you one can. They don't give you two cans for 2 weeks worth of stuff. So it apparently it's not just isolated to us. So thank you all for y'all's help, and I appreciate it.
Thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you.
I hope I don't have to come back next month.
I hope so, too. All right, Kristen Powers.
Kristen Powers, 6063 Swepsonville, Saxapaha Road, Graham. So I was recently informed that the county will be participating in Sustainable Alamance's Reserve One program, which is reserving one job in the county to support marginalized folks with employment, including those who have been homeless, survivors of violence, veterans, people with criminal records, and folks with mental illnesses. And I was wondering if the board had any discussions about implementing this procedure called Ban the Box, which encourages municipalities and counties and governments to hire individuals with criminal records by withholding the question about criminal records on the initial application, but still allowing, of course, to ensure the safety of employees and the people they're working with upon conditional offer employment. So at that point, the question would be asked. And this helps mitigate people who have criminal records are very concerned with their status and may not apply to jobs if they think they're going to be tossed out, which is viable because 50% of people with jobs people apply to with criminal records have their applications tossed at onset. Band of Box has been successful in places like Spring Lake, Buncombe County, Wake County, Durham County, and even the entire state of Georgia. And I would like to hear what would have to happen for the board to commit to such a policy change, what would the next steps would entail. And I'd like to offer up a resource of from the National Employment Law Project. They have examples of government policies and ordinances that on their website that could help with this research process. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner, comments?
To her comment, Clyde, we have used sustainable Alamance numerous times in the county.
Yes.
And Phil Bowers has a great program that he's working in.
And he vets these folks with a similar problem that this young lady just spoke about and has had quite success
getting placement for him.
Employed.
So are we opening up one slot for such an employee?
We are at the landfill again. Thanks to the landfill staff, they've worked with Phil and several folks with stepping up to Lynn Allison, I know, to put together a process for how that would work. So the landfill is participating.
So I'd like to say we have discussed that ban the box issue, and I can't remember in what context it was discussed, whether it was at the board here or another one of the many committees I serve on.
I think
it's a great idea. I'll say that employment of people coming out of prison is a huge issue. It's a huge toll, and it's just without jobs, people just recycle back into the prison system again. And so it's a great way to offer some opportunities.
I think Sherry Hook might be able to comment on our current process, just
sure.
If the board is interested.
So I think what you're referring to is there was an article in Times News maybe a year and a half, 2 years ago about Ban the Box.
It's been about that long ago.
We have not been asking about criminal backgrounds or convictions on applications for a long time. We never went through a formal process of saying we're participating in Ban the Box, but that's essentially what we did.
Okay.
So if you're looking on our website, you're not going to see a policy that says we've implemented that, but we have implemented it.
That's our practice.
Mm-hmm.
It's the practice. It's in
yeah.
place.
Great.
I think it's a dumb practice. If you're gonna commit crimes and be put in jail, you have given up your rights to be treated fair. And that's the way I feel. That's the way most of the people in this county feel. You know, we expect you to live, do the right thing and treat other people the right way, and you don't end up in jail.
All right. Any other responses? Okay. Next is approval of the agenda. One item that needs to be added to our agenda is Mr. Mac Williams from the Chamber of Commerce is here to present about requesting a public hearing for an economic development project. So that would be under number 7 on our agenda. It would come down to number 4. So with that addition, do we have a motion for approval of the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, so the consent agenda is there. Is there anything that needs to be addressed with the consent agenda?
I move approval of the consent agenda.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. All right, next we have Mr. George Daniel. Is here from the Daniel Thomas Law Firm of Yanceyville, North Carolina, to give us a presentation about the opioid crisis and legal options that are available to the county in tackling that difficult problem.
Thank you, Madam Chairman and members of the board. It's good to be back and see you. First of all, I had attempted to get some data to you. We thought we had done that, and if I may, I'd like to give each of you a package. May I pass that out? Mm-hmm.
Of course.
And
thank you.
This is just a small amount of material. But let me say, I think you've seen in the media, in television, everywhere, even in the campaigns last year, what has been said all across this nation with an opioid crisis and epidemic. It has really come to bear since we came out of the election season last year and into this year. We've seen 60 Minutes, we've seen news article after news article. And I want to tell you, I see my buddy here, the sheriff, back years ago when I was at State and he was East Carolina. We were he was much better football player than I was, but we were playing. And, you know, I think about that fall of 69, but, you know, in 1970 is when the Controlled Substance Act was passed. And at that point in time, it was created a middleman where it used to be when we had controlled substances such as opioids, the manufacturer went directly to the end user for the pharmacy, doctors, hospital. And so while we were finishing up our college degree, I go on to law school, Terry goes to SBI, and we run into each other again when I get back finally out of Wake Forest from law school. And I started to see a little bit of what controlled substances were all about. Fast forward a little bit, and certainly the sheriff did, because he was in and out of all of the enforcement and drug bust. And then I get fortunate enough to be able to go to the legislature, and I really saw then. Because from 1986 to 1994, we were in the prison building business. And I know firsthand, because from where I come from, we didn't have a whole lot of state buildings up in Caswell, but I knew a little something about prisons because of Ivy Bluff and the Yancey unit. So we had to build them, we had to build them fast. And a lot of this had to do with the onslaught of property crimes, drug-related crimes, and little did I know that here we would fast forward almost 24 years later, and we're dealing with what is now an epidemic. There's no way in the world we're going to arrest our way out of this. There's really no way in the world we're going to, in a sense, treat our way out of this. We've got to get in front of this. And what I found out is that there have been a group of folks that have been testing this in West Virginia, some fine lawyers, and I can tell you, I'm no mass tort or multi-district litigator. I'm a local, hometown, country lawyer. But I know there's a problem. Early on last year, Paul Coates and Don Vaughn were contacted by Ed Hill out of West Virginia, who had spearheaded litigation there. And they started at the state level. But then they were able to bring lawsuits locally at the county level, and one of the theories they use is abatement of a public nuisance. Now, I'm going to leave you with some information so you can see that tonight about how that works. But they were able to find, and in the process of this litigation, get a hold of some very private data. They call it ARCOS. But through discovery, they were able to find that of the 1.2 million, excuse me, 1.2, I think 700, anyway, it came out that over a six-year period, the population of West Virginia were prescribed or had opioids over 400 apiece per head. That tells you that's something wrong, because in that Controlled Substance Act, wholesale distributors were created, not only were they given the opportunity to be to have a business now, but they were to be the watchdog. And they have grown to the point that there are well over 800 across the United States. The largest three are McKesson Corporation, Cardinal Health, not Cardinal Mental Health, and AmerisourceBergen. I won't necessarily get into all that, but there is where a lot of the issues we find are creating the problems. So much money, they each make earn over $100 billion a year, and when you're earning that much money, it pretty well has shown taken its toll in as far as law enforcement and cutting off. So, as far as the information, this is in a sense a preliminary. When I talked to Clyde earlier, in the we set up a meeting, brought two of the national council to Alamance County, just sort of tried to arrange a meeting so we could explain personally what this group is trying to do. And again, this group is a group of six law firms. They have been in litigation all over the United States before, in tobacco litigation. They've got funds in which to fund the litigation. They will fully fund this litigation, and they will also come in and bring their experts in to help the counties to determine uniquely what Alamance County's damages are, what a damage model should be. How I got brought into it, Mr. Paul Coates gave me a call, said, "You know any folks around in Alamance County?" I said, "Yeah, sure do." He said, "Well, George, you know, we want to introduce this group to Alamance County." And so that is why we're here tonight. I put in the package a resolution. I've also put in there, lawyers, fee contracts. And I know that from what I understand from what Mr. Albright says, that there will be a presentation coming I don't want to steal Clyde's thunder, but I didn't want to take up so much of your time if we're going to do RFPs.
Do you want me to do my part now?
That'd be great.
Don't want to kick you out of the
out
of the booth, but I put a little handout on your table up there for you folks. I think maybe we take a broader look at this, because opium's been around a long time. And I've got on the third or fourth page a history of opium. 1861, during the Civil War, medics used it. In 1898, heroin was produced commercially by Bayer Aspirin Company. Did you know that? To take the place of the habit-forming morphine, because so many people hooked on morphine, all these veterans. So Bayer was producing it and dispensing it to individuals who were addicted to morphine. In 1914, Congress said, "You know, this is nuts. We got to pass an act, the Harrison Narcotics Act, passed, which required doctors to actually write prescriptions for the Bayer heroin tablet." Then in 1924, they said, now that's 10 years later, the Anti-Heroin Act banned the sale and production of heroin in the United States. Then in 1970, the Controlled Substance Act, which you've already mentioned, came about. And 10 years later, in the New England Journal of Medicine, there was an article entitled, "Addiction is Rare in Patients Treated with Narcotics." Confusing, isn't it? So in 1995, OxyContin was introduced, which is a slow-release drug. And May 10, 2007, a law firm in Wisconsin assisted the United States government in going after Purdue Pharma. That's one of the big producers of this. Misleading advertising. And they paid $634.5 million in fines. And three of their executives went to prison. Then the DEA in 2015 really cracked down. They arrested 280 people, including 22 doctors and pharmacists, in the biggest drug bust in history. And the title of it was Operation Pilluded. Operation Pilluded. I'm saying all this to put it in perspective. We have the federal government cracking down on doctors that are prescribing these drugs. They're shutting down these mills that produce the pills. And they've legalized marijuana in a lot of states. And the drug cartels are switching from marijuana because everybody can grow it in their backyard now, so it's not a moneymaker anymore. So they need a moneymaker. So what's the moneymaker? Heroin, illegal fentanyl, And these people that are on prescription drugs are getting a hold of this stuff. And 91 people a day died from overdosing opioids in 2015. As an attorney that has just a little bit of experience with litigation with gigantic firms that have billions of dollars in profits, I can tell you that when you poke the bear, you're going to get an avalanche of discovery. And we're going to have people's depositions being taken, probably including members of this board, if we declare a nuisance. And, I mean, you can hear from the health director, you can hear from the Susan Osmond DSS, and we'll build a case, and if that's the route you want to go, then that's the route we'll go. I'm going to suggest that we, and I've also put in the packet a request for information. And I talked to George about this. This request for information will be sent out to the attorneys that have contacted me, and I've had numerous firms contact me. And what we're going to do is, what I would recommend that this board do, is let's ask these firms what their theory is, what their costs are going to be, and how they intend to help these people in Alamance County. I don't know how many we have here that are hooked on these drugs, but these are the factors I think you need to consider. This firm in Ohio has managed to get the panel on multi-district litigation to appoint U.S. District Court Judge Dan Polster of Ohio, who is going after Purdue Pharma and Johnson & Johnson. And this judge is moving fast. He is... He's already ruled that he intends to push for a settlement last week. He said, I'm not just going to move money around, folks. We're going to solve this problem. Now, this is a federal judge who represents parties that have sued a county in Iowa, a city in Seattle, Washington. They've all sued Purdue Pharma. And one method of this is multi-district litigation, which I think George mentioned earlier. Something I'm not really familiar with, but this is a judge who seems to really take this to heart. And he said in one of his statements he made during this hearing was 91 Americans are dying a day because of this crisis, and we're just not going to push money around. We're going to get a global resolution to it. So my advice to you is let's consider all of these factors, because it really is it's huge. I think 40 states attorneys generals are now involved in this, including ours. He is studying it, our attorney general. I've got a meeting on the 26th of this month with the county association to see what his thoughts are. But it's still in the formative stage. He would bring a lawsuit in the Latin is parens patria, the father of the country type lawsuit, which is really the only type of lawsuits that have been successful against Purdue. I told George earlier, once I met with him and Don and Paul, I started doing some research on this. I didn't realize how big this was. This is huge. These people make billions of dollars. They have manufactured so many of these drugs, it's just mind-boggling to me. In 2014, 7.8 billion hydrocodone pills were dispensed. 7.8 billion. And in 2014, 4.9 billion oxycodone pills were dispensed. And Americans represent about 99.7% of the world's hydrocodone consumption. It's just out of control. And there's an avalanche of litigation all over this country. And cities, counties, and other communities are filing lawsuits. The history of Purdue Pharma, when individuals have tried to sue them, claiming products liability, Purdue has said, well, you misused it. Because a lot of these folks, when they get addicted, they will crush the pill to get instant euphoria, so it's not time released. And they have won on that numerous times. They've tried to get class action status. And they've been shot down. The plaintiffs have been shot down on that. So what George is telling you is, I think, is very accurate. It's just what firm do you want to represent Alamance County, and under what terms? And
And I think the best way to do that on something this important is to put out a request for a proposal. And I'll give them, in fact, I'll just give them my copy. You have one in your packet.
So I'd like to say something.
Of course.
Well, Senator Daniel, can I still call you Senator?
I'll answer that easy.
Just so you know, we had an opioid forum here in our county on December the 8th. It was a whole half day. Steve Mange from the, or Mange, I think his name is, from the Attorney General's office was one of our speakers, had a lot of great speakers. We went over a lot of that data that that both of you had submitted, and it's definitely a big issue here.
Yes.
In this county. And we didn't really talk about this lawsuit, I don't believe. Was that mentioned? I don't think, Amy, you were there. I don't think Steve. But this lawsuit was talked about at a meeting that I missed at the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. And I know the, I think it was the board that decided not to do a class action suit, that they felt like this should be up to individual counties, and that because every county's situation is different, that we'd have better success in getting damages if each county approached it individually, if they so chose to do. Is that what you understand?
And the county in control of their own damages.
That way
doesn't come so to the state.
Yeah, I think that was probably the biggest. Yeah,
back to the county, Commissioner Byrd. And the there was the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners.
Yeah, that's what.
And there was a presentation. I think there was a presentation in November. I think was that the county attorneys or the commission? It was commission. And Paul Farrell from the West Virginia firm that we are affiliated with, he presented. Mike Fuller was there. Of course, Paul and I think Don, they were there. And so not all the counties were able to attend, but they came away and a lot. And as a result of that, and I just want to tell you, New Hanover and Buncombe have already filed. Countdown County lawsuit. I think I don't know about Wilmington yet, but Rockingham, Surrey, Stokes, I know at least three of those four, and it may have been all of those. Randolph County has joined in. Burke County. I'm going back to Caswell tonight, and again, but. We're kind of a little pea in a big dish out here from Castle, but we're going back there tonight in Person County. Even though they haven't filed, they have signed, they have passed the resolution and are going to use this firm. So I see what Clyde is saying. The one question that I've got about is that certainly you as the leaders of this community are going stepping up and you want to do something and you're showing you're doing something. But I think this thing of multi-district litigation, where it's different from being a class action, you just don't get to, you know, everybody's going along and you join the class. This is one of these where you get your own, you have your lawsuit. And with this judge that's saying that he wants to do something, I think, have it tried in 2019.
He said they're going to settle it this year or he'll have a trial January.
And he says he's going to turn the plaintiffs against loose on the defendants. The defendants are loose on the plaintiffs. He says, you know, because people, they're upset about this. And he says they don't want to hear some great legal premises. They want results. And I just want to make certain that the counties I'm affiliated with are going to have a seat at the table. This litigation will be so large that they've got tiers of how the executive committee, can you believe that, executive committees of how they're going to run a lawsuit. Well, the five major national law firms in this, they hold, and I can't remember exactly what the number is. Paul may know. Paul?
Yeah. Briefly, an MDL is run by various committees of lawyers. Our group has
five. It's Paul Coates, by the way.
Paul Coates from Greensboro. I'm some address somewhere. But our group has five leadership positions on the executive board, which is more than any other group, our national group of six law firms. They'll be in the settlement discussions firsthand. They'll be in all the decision making firsthand. They represent over 200 entities in the country right now. And we are in discussions with about 35 counties and some cities in North Carolina with our particular group through the national group too. So we it's a serious problem, as we all know. I tell you, I looked up statistics for Alamance County, and you have 83 prescriptions per 100 people. So for every 100 people, that's 83 prescriptions. And I did a little math on that. And if each prescription, Alamance County, 150,000 people roughly, you have anywhere from 4 million pills to almost 6 million pills in this county. That's the, if depending on a 30-day prescription or a 60-day or more. So, yeah, in this room, three-fourths of the people have a prescription in their pocket for an opioid. Now, I don't believe that to be the case. The sheriff did check us downstairs. But that's how prevalent it is. It is terrible. And 80% of all your heroin users started on pills. That's just the facts. So, and as the pills, as we cut off the supply of pills, where are they going, Sheriff?
Yeah. Heroin straight.
And it's cheaper.
Yes, sir.
And it's cheaper. And so we've got these problems. We'd like to help you fund a solution.
What do we need to do tonight?
Well, I would suggest there's a resolution that George has prepared declaring it a nuisance. But I would suggest maybe we should hear from the health director and our DSS director and get some facts on the record before the board determines that there is a nuisance, because that is going to be a document in a lawsuit. I just don't want the board to just say I signed this resolution because my attorney told me to. I want you to really have some basis for it.
We have time to do that. I mean, I'd feel more comfortable doing that.
I think we need to move, but I think we can wait.
And right along with Clyde said, the last thing, because I know all y'all, last thing I want to do is bring you a pig in a poke over here at Alamance County, who I think is very dear to me. All my friends are here. So I want to make sure we get it right. But I also want us to keep an eye on what they're doing. It's because I know with a request for information, request for proposal, yeah, we're talking about, 60 more days, 30 days? Okay.
If the board approves sending that out, I'll go ahead and send it out. Yeah. I've been contacted by numerous firms. I'll just send that request for
information. And I don't see anything wrong with requesting information.
I just want to make certain if we're going to have, again, presentations. I'm proud enough of this crowd I'm with. I want you to see them side by side, the other ones that may show some interest.
But it may turn out that you want to have a special meeting just for that purpose, because that'd be pretty lengthy if you get a bunch of lawyers in the room.
That's okay. Okay.
I would think that would be proper.
If you'd approve that, issue that tomorrow, weather allowing.
So we don't need to vote on the approving the request for information for special counsel.
If you would just authorize me to send that out, the request for information.
I'll make a motion that we pursue the request for information as outlined by the attorney.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye. And if our next meeting, if we can have Stacy and Susan come with some facts and figures that will enable you to declare a public nuisance. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you so much. The whole thing just makes me so furious to think that we've got 83 prescriptions for 100 people in Alamance County and the suffering that causes in our community. And then you've got these distributors who are laying around in Palm Beach or Manhattan, wherever really, really rich people go, I would not happen to know. But that these people are laying around enjoying themselves and living the high life off of the incredible misery and suffering of the people in our communities just like ours. I think it's shocking and horrifying. And I just I hope that we can find a way to bring some of that money back to Alamance County so we can help people get some treatment and also do some prevention and educate people about the consequences of the decision to continue to take these drugs. So thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Great. See you up in the All right, next on our agenda tonight is a presentation by Mr. Frank Bell of the Alamance County Farm Bureau. He's going to talk to us about the farmland preservation funding.
Thank you, Madam Chair, County Commissioners, Mr. Haygood, and county employees, especially Tori, for keep putting up with me because I pop in her office unexpectedly and she so graciously takes care of my problems. Thank you kindly. We appreciate that. Tonight is probably going to be history made. 16 years ago, in September of 2001, Tim Sutton probably was on the board.
He was born down here.
I thought it was 18.
Yeah, I think it was going back to 1800.
Well, anyway, we're close. The county commissioners appointed a voluntary ag district board. And tonight we've got several members of those various boards here with us. We've got Mr. Danley, Mr. Moore, Henry Vines, Vaughn Willoughby, Mr. Eddie Kerr is on the Farm Bureau board. They came because for 16 years we've been trying to get farmland preservation funded. It's been a long road. In 2001, there was 9 people appointed to that board. I happened to be one of the 9. There was 3 of us appointed for 3 years, Steve Love, myself, and Jane Isley. We served on that official board back then. It's been 16 years in the making. We've come a long ways. Some of the problems that we were faced with back then was, and some of you can remember being in the agricultural community, neighbors moving in, buying a house in the suburban area or in a rural area, and all at once they complained they smelled something that wasn't what they've been used to smelling. Or they found some noise out there that they wasn't used to hearing. Or they seen dust in the air that they wasn't used to seeing. So that was one of our main chores to begin with. So we started with realtors. When they come into the community to buy a house, they check with the realtor, automatically gave them information. You may be seeing things that you ain't been used to seeing. It worked. As of this moment, we've got in the county 386 acres of permanently protected farmland preservation acreage. That's a far cry from what the applications have been. All of you know that our problem has been money. Every year, everybody comes to Graham begging in January. I didn't come to beg. I come to offer a solution tonight to the problem that we've had for 16 years. We did a survey back then to find out what the county was paying for services. We found out the residential market, for every dollar of tax revenue, the county paid $1.46 for it. We also learned that forestry and farmland, for every dollar of revenue that the farmer put in or paid Graham for taxes, they only spent 59 cents. That's a pretty good return on investment. Commercial, as we all know, for every dollar that commercial puts in the tax till ever here in this county, they only spend 23 cents. Those are the things that we found out in 2006 of where our money was and where it was being spent. Fast forward, we have spent several years of application and hundreds of acres of land that could be put in farmland preservation. We all know sitting here and what in the strategic planning area, what the number one problem was, our number one preservation was, they wanted to see farmland preserved and green space preserved. That's important. That's our heritage, folks. This county has been providing food and fiber for a lot of people for a long period of time. So, we have seen applications decline. We've seen applications decline because they sent in applications, they were looked at, we didn't have no money. I know for a fact, up until this year, Brian, that we, for 2 years running, we didn't have even anything put in the budget. This year we got $50,000. Let me ask you the question, what can you buy for $50,000 as it pertains to land? I've got a sheet here, and I was hoping that Tim would be here. I think his home county is Randolph, isn't it? I think he goes back there a lot. I've got an advertisement back here that says land for $25 an acre. Those days is gone, folks. There is no land for that. But anyway, we have come a long ways in the 16 years. Little did I know, Bill Lashley, in 2010, when you and I and Tom Manning sat over at
the South.
South and had a sub and talked about an employee for the county that could go in and police and bring our present use value program up to speed. Little did we know that those employees are still here today, and those are the employees that's gonna pay for farmland preservation in this county. We did an audit, and you've got a copy of that audit. We have rolled out a farmland preservation. There's been 1,472 audits. 29% of all the people in this county defaulted. They were not eligible for a program that they've been getting for the last 15, 20, 30 years. We didn't know that. The reason we didn't know that, because we didn't have employees in the county that could go out and check and see if you were in compliance. This board approved people that we put on the payroll and went out there and checked, and we found out we have recovered, this is after cost net, of $1,015,000 net profit has been moved back to the bottom line of this county because we went out there and did our job. That's important. Little did we know that those people that defaulted in present use value and paid a penalty to come back in the program is the people that's going to pay for farmland preservation. That's who's going to have to pay for it. You see, if you play by the rules, good things happen. If you don't play by the rules, sometimes bad things happen. We went to the Voluntary Ag District Committee. Mr. Haygood, Seth, Amy, we asked a question. You see, we ain't never had no money to fund farmland preservation because we didn't know what to ask for. It's hard to get something if you don't know what you want. So we went to the Ag Volunteer Ag District. They look at the applications they've had over the last 15, 16 years, and they came up with a figure of $250,000. Mr. Haygood, Jeremy Akins, and myself sat down and we massaged those numbers as it relates to what you have there on in your thing. And they will work. We got a plenty of money coming in every year to farmland to budget every year $250,000 for farmland preservation. With $250,000 budgeted every year, we can make a difference in Alamance County in farmland preservation, believe me. That's what the citizens want. That's what I want. Little did I know 16 years ago that we would come full circle back to where we are tonight to pay for what everybody in this county wants, and we ain't got to go nowhere and find the money. It's coming right back to us. Some people call that a miracle. I think it's a blessing that we can pay for everything that we want out of agricultural money. We don't have to ask for nobody else. You know something? It's amazing to me, and this all started, Bill, because 19,000 complaints. Y'all remember that in 2009?
Oh yeah, very well.
When you get 19,000 irritable customers that your taxes ain't right, that's what happens to you. You lose it all. I'm here tonight to tell you I'm grateful for the opportunity to be able to present to you county commissioners a solution to farmland preservation. And I highly recommend that you make it a priority in the budget for 2018 and going forward that we can depend upon $250,000 and going forward. I thank you for your time. If you got any questions, I'll try to answer. Bob?
Well, I just want to make sure I understand, and maybe others will learn from this too, this farm preservation program. So the county puts up money, but it's also added to money that's being provided most often by the state. Sometimes the state doesn't provide it, but also a nonprofit organization that exists to help to preserve farmland. And the collection of those monies from the three sources are used to purchase permanent easements from farm owners for all or maybe part of their farms to make sure that that property will never be used for anything else but farming from here on. Is that essentially how that works?
Brad Moore.
I've been going to a lot of the voluntary ag district meetings. This is what I've tried to learn. I've missed some here lately because of conflicts. But
yes, sir, that is correct. There is other funding, so from the state of North Carolina, they do have a program. And what we provide from Alamance County is a match,
right,
or part of a match. Many of you familiar with grants and how they work. The basic premise is the state will only pay 50% of the value of whatever that value is of that farm or that area of the farm.
It's really the value of the easement. Well,
yes, you're exactly. It's easement. The value of the easement.
Right.
The other, in our particular cases, most of the time, 25% they were, 50% from the state, 25% from the county, and most of the time the other 25% comes from the landowner in the form of a donation. Many times, even with the donation part and the county's 25%, is still anywhere from $80,000 to $100,000 per project. And these are on farms from anywhere from usually around 70 to 90 acres. For example, if someone said they wanted to put in a 300-acre farm, we currently wouldn't have enough of our match to send an application to Raleigh. In years past, we have sent applications and they were not selected. So as in the past, when funding did come from the county, sometimes that funding does build up.
So when I was at the last Ag District meeting, and Amy was there too, I understood that you were thinking about coming to us to, as a matter of practice or policy, I'm not sure which, take a percentage, a given percentage of the amount that the increased tax revenue that we receive from people going off the value-added
present use value
system of taxation to regular fair market value, and then that percentage would kind of be give assurance that we're going to have a steady stream of funding from the county,
and that would be the source of funds. Jeremy and Brian, look, we discussed that other morning, and we figured that we would be ahead of the game for the time being, not to say that we can't change, mm-hmm. but that we would be better off to obligate ourselves to for a set number to begin with and let the program progress, and that is the basis. There was discussion, and there has still been discussion as to percentage, but we chose to go with 250.
So that's five times what we've been doing.
Right. We had 50,000 in our budget from this year.
That's correct.
A year before that, last 2 years, we ain't had anything.
Okay, yeah.
The state appropriated $2.6 million for farmland preservation this year. And I don't know where they'll be, where to be used up, but Stephen Ross, Representative Ross, heads up that committee. And that's one of the reasons why we got to 50,000 this year. You don't ask, you don't get.
If I can speak.
Of course, please.
Madam Chair, you know, we know, my office, we know that if you're going through the strategic plan process, that ag is one of the pillars of our strategic plan. It's something that we had a lot of feedback from the community about, desire for county government, which we're one of the few, if not the only local government in Alamance County that's actively supporting ag. And you know, last year we made ag a priority. We got the funding back. It's not at the level to make the big dent that I think our ag community would like for us to make, but it was a foothold. And we were also able to support things like the FCS position at Cooperative Extension, which we were very glad to do. We were able to do all those things because we know it's important to our community. It worked in the budget. One of my discussions with Mr. Bell and Jeremy have been, you know, I realize this is an important part of life in Alamance County, and we would make this a priority for the upcoming budget to try to fit in and to bring you a budget that balances and includes these funds that the ag folks are talking about. So, you know, we've met with Mr. Bell and Jeremy and taking a look at where this money's coming from and how the PUV program audit is working, and that is a fantastic program. I think Jeremy's indicated they've run through maybe two-thirds of the enrolled farms to go back and check and say, are you eligible for this? And then when they're found to not be, we receive an immediate pay, and then it also puts that property back on the payrolls at its proper tax value. So we're every time a farm rolls out, we're seeing that too. I think what we've talked about is the $250,000 amount being a target for 18-19 as opposed to that percentage. It is more dependable. We're going to see that income coming in off farms that have returned back to full value forever, for as long as they're, unless they're put back in the program. You know, that's a little less predictable with the yearly rollback in. So it's there. It's a real figure. It's significant money, but I think from a budget standpoint, I would certainly prefer to try to shoot for the figure Mr. Bell's talking about, and want to bring you a budget in the not too distant future.
So this is moving forward. We're not really not doing that tonight.
That's
you're
great.
Just saying, okay.
Yes.
Well, I want to say just one more thing, and that is, first of all, I believe in strategic planning, and we went through the process, and this was identified as one of our strategies for a successful community. And it also dovetails into another strategy, which Amy was a real champion for, is one of her platform items when she ran, and that is smart growth, because you need to protect our land if you're going to have smart growth as we move forward. So.
Well, thank you so much for bringing this to
thank
us.
You, yeah.
We can see why Mr. Bell was the 2016 Alamance County Volunteer of the Year. Remember that well.
Yeah, we appreciate that.
Thank you so much. Next on our agenda is the Mental Health Diversion and Restoration Center grant, and Mr. Haygood.
Thank you, Madam Chair and Commissioners. Good evening. I know the board is familiar with our Alamance County Stepping Up initiative, so I won't go over a lot about the initiative, but I want to make sure you know this group is comprised of representatives from our Sheriff's Office, our District Attorney's Office, Social Services, Health, Cardinal Innovations, Alamance County Government, as well as Cone Health and private physicians and patient families. There's a lot of representatives
and
in
the North Carolina Psychiatric Association.
Yes, indeed. That's right. And all these folks are working together in Alamance County to improve mental health services to folks that live here. This is one of the, you know, since I've been manager, this is one of the very first initiatives I got involved with. And I've been very impressed at the collaboration that you all have seen, too. The Stepping Up initiative is working on ways to divert mental health patients from our jail, from our emergency room, to a facility where they could get the proper care that they need, wraparound services at in a much more efficient manner from a cost perspective. The priority is services and getting the proper services to these folks, but it's also, in the long term, a more efficient way. Not too long ago, a couple months ago, several representatives of Stepping Up Initiative traveled to San Antonio, where we looked at their program there for their Stepping Up program, which included a nationally renowned mental health diversion and restoration center that was very successful, that was very educational for all of us to see. We've come back. The Stepping Up group has toured county buildings to take a look at them to see if we had any that might possibly work, so we're not out trying to acquire another building. We've looked at some of our own inventory, identified the Elderly Services building over on Martin Street, used to be Old Mental Health, as a possible center for a new diversion and restoration center. Stepping Up group worked to put together a plan, like a business plan, of how that would operate, and submitted that plan to Cardinal Innovations. And Cardinal took a look at our plan, and they are very familiar with all the collaboration and work that is going on locally in Alamance County to make this happen. And they saw value in this plan that folks here from Alamance County put together. So tonight we have a great opportunity to take a step to make this proposed Diversion and Restoration Center a reality. And at this point I'd like to ask Susan Osborne to come up and speak a few words about Stepping Up and Diversion and Restoration. So Susan.
Thank you. So I just wanted to highlight for you what I think is probably a shining example of county government working at its best for the people that we have here in Alamance County. If y'all remember back in 2015, you passed a resolution. From that resolution came a task force. It hasn't been that long. People talk about levels of bureaucracy in government. This has moved fairly quickly. We've been funded with a federal grant that have put some initiatives forward. But when we were looking at this in 2016, our work group came up with a vision, and I just want to read that for you. A community, Alamance County, will be a community that respects, supports, and embraces persons with mental illness, and whose system of health, mental health, law enforcement, justice, human services, public safety, and advocacy work together in deliberate and coordinated fashion to optimize the level of service provided for them and to minimize the level of incarceration in our county detention center. So we've moved forward. We have lots of initiatives in place when we were working on our grant and our project timeline. Our vision was this diversion center, and we weren't sure how we were going to get there, and if we would get there, but we knew we needed it, and we knew that our citizens needed it. The sheriff and his perseverance of helping us understand that he runs the largest mental health facility in our community and what that means for his staff and the work they have to do every day. Where's our chief deputy? Stand up here, Chief Deputy. Tell them what mantra you brought to us.
So I do think one of the key things is just the right thing to do. So we have a population of folks that are winding up in jail for lack of options for the officer on the street. They encounter someone in crisis. Currently, they have a couple options. Take them to the ED, emergency department, where they may sit for hours or days. That's not efficient.
Or weeks.
and it's that long. And we're having to keep an officer there and rotate officers out with them. So that's not efficient. We're taking officers off the street, the cost of that, or we're bringing them to jail and we're spending $70 a day, Sheriff, plus with their meds to house them. And maybe there's some options where we could divert them somewhere else, get them some help, some services, save the taxpayers money, and just do the right thing by somebody whose only offense is that they were sick. And we're seeing a lot of folks that wind up in jail for misdemeanors because they're sick.
Mm-hmm. So we're moving forward. We're excited. We're moving off our successes in the model of the Family Justice Center, that the county would be the backbone, not building a department, but providing an infrastructure and using a private-public partnership to allow for this diversion center, which will be 24/7. It'll be a place where law enforcement can bring folks, drop them off. They can stay up to 23 hours. They can get the services they need for nonviolent offenders and hopefully reintegrated back in our community. So, Bob Berg, chairs.
Well,
I'll let him introduce
co-chair. You and I are co-chair.
With co-chair. But, that's right. And I'll let him introduce our guest from Cardinal.
Well, and I just want to preface that we applied for a grant through Cardinal Innovations, and now that I'm on the board, although I haven't taken the oath yet, we'll be sworn in at the end of this month, the new reconstituted board of directors for Cardinal Innovations. But way before any of this that happened, we applied for a grant to help us with this, and Cardinal had was familiar with some of the other activities going on in other parts of the state and maybe country, and Susan explained, we responded positively to our grant request. So we have with us tonight the interim executive director of Cardinal Innovations. He's a candidate for the permanent director, and so it'll be up to our newly constituted board to make that decision as to who's going to be our chief executive officer. But we're really pleased to have Trey Sutton with us tonight. And with Trey is the senior community executive. So, you know, Cardinal serves 20 counties, and they're divided up into regions. And we're in what's called the central region, which is Orange, Person, Chatham, Alamance, and Caswell. And so Rick is the senior community executive for that region. And so we're really pleased to have them both here. And Trey, did you want to
just speak? We're excited to be here. We're excited to partner. And we're really excited about the Diversion Center. So glad to be here and glad to see it's coming to fruition. You know.
To Bob's point, this has been going on for a long time. We've been working on it over a year now. So we're super excited. It's a good fit for us. And,
And Rick has been really an active member of our leadership group for the Stepping Up initiative, and he's been very valuable.
So what you have before you this evening, Commissioners, is Cardinal is offering a grant to Alamance County in the amount of $1.2 million. This money is to be used to establish this Diversion and Restoration Center in Alamance County. County Attorney has prepared a project ordinance that you have in your possession that would receive the money. If you vote to approve this evening, we would receive the money the ordinance puts it in a fund to be used specifically for this purpose.
Let me ask you this.
Yes, sir.
All right, is this going to be a county department?
No, it is not. It would be a county building, probably. We're not 100% sure on that, but right now, the idea is the building is the county's.
Yeah.
We would be responsible for the upkeep of the building and the utilities for the building, but that's all. Staff would be private. We use our maintenance of effort funds to contract currently for a lot of the services that would be provided in the building. So it would not be a new county department.
And I might add that this is similar, not exactly the same, but similar, and Susan can help speak to this, to the Family Justice Center. So we have one staff person at the Family Justice Center, and that's Cindy Brady, but everybody else that's in that building are private agencies providing services. Service providers, yeah.
Well, great. Well, we're going to need a motion to approve the project ordinance to accept this $1.2 million.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion?
Thanks for all the hard work.
Yeah, I'd just like to take the opportunity to say, wow, y'all have worked so hard for such a long time, and it's an honor for me just to participate in it from the small piece that I've done, which has really been nothing. So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Wonderful.
Thank you, Mr. Sutton, Mr. Brody.
Thank you.
All right, next on our agenda is Mr. Mac Williams of the Alamance Chamber of Commerce with an economic development situation.
Mac, we're glad to have you here tonight.
Well, thank you. It's a nice way to start the new year. Mm-hmm. We have an opportunity to work with an existing industry who is contemplating an expansion project. And I'm here to ask the commissioners to set a date for a public hearing on that matter. I think your next meeting is February 5th, 9:00 in the morning. If my request at this point, as you know, my process is a two-step process, or you all's process is a two-step process. This is the first one where I come and ask you to set a date for the hearing. And then, of course, the second step is the hearing itself. The other component of your process is that at this time, I disclose the company name, and that company would be Honda Power Equipment.
I will make a motion that we have a public hearing on February 5th.
I'll second it.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion?
Is that the same company that's already here?
The one in Swepsonville, yes, sir.
All right, all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Great, we have a
thank
public hearing
on
February 5th.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the flexibility of getting me on the agenda tonight.
We're always happy to accommodate you. All right, Mr. Manager, do you have a report?
Only thing I'd like the opportunity to say is thank you to all the folks with the Alamance County Stepping Up Initiative for all the hard work that they have done making this Diversion Restoration Center possible. Thank you, all of you. And also would like to say, as you heard earlier in the public comments, our landfill has really stepped up and done a good job handling a lot of questions and concerns about waste handling. So thank you to their staff, too. So that's all I have.
Awesome. Do we have any commissioner comments tonight?
I'd like to make just a quick report. That I was got elected or appointed to the Cardinal Innovation Healthcare Board, and we haven't been sworn in yet, but we had our first meeting. It was kind of an orientation meeting on January the 6th. It was a Saturday. It lasted just about all day. And there is a really important tone that was set at that meeting with respect to governing Cardinal Innovations Healthcare. We had one of our first presentations at that meeting was from the a gentleman from the School of Government who's an expert on the legalities of mental health. And he pointed out to us that the former board and the former, I guess you might call it the corporate culture, was not one of a governmental entity, which Cardinal Innovations is. So Cardinal Innovations, if those who've been around for a long time will remember that we used to have the Mental Health Center, mm-hmm. and it was formed under the auspices of the Mental Health Authority. It was really the Alamance Casual Mental Health Developmental Disabilities and Substance Abuse Authority. And that authority means it was established by state statute, and it was a unit of government, just like the county is a unit of government, or any city is a unit of government, this is a unit of government. And then that, over time, morphed into what's called an LME, local management entity, and then that morphed into what's called a managed care organization. But the legal basis for the authority is still present today, even though the business model has kind of changed from an entity that provides services directly with its own employees to an entity that manages the care of individuals by contracting with other entities, other providers in the community. So the business model changed. But, and then the other thing that's changed is that because there are some statutory requirements for LMEs and MCOs to take on larger populations for efficiency purposes, I guess, Cardinal ended up being responsible for the mental health services for 20 counties. So it's the largest MCO LME in the state. But over time, it kind of lost its governmental authority personality and kind of morphed into acting more like a big corporation. And this gentleman from the School of Government pointed out, he goes to the website and he said, just look at the bios of the people who work at Cardinal. They talk about this is what they do for the company, and the company is doing this. And they kept talking about company. When you hear company, you really think about a private corporate organization, not a governmental authority. And so that's that kind of culture kept growing, and that's what led to what was in the papers about, you know, the CEO being paid very high salaries and lavish retreats and so on. So now that board has been fired. We have a new board coming on, and the new board consists of 21 voting members plus two or three non-voting members. And the voting members, 17 of the 21 voting members were chosen by, and this is statutorily required, by county commissioners from the counties in which they're served. So we had a big nominating committee here meeting in Alamance County to choose who those 17 voting members were going to be. Well, and I was part of that group, and we elected to have five county commissioners serve on that board, plus myself, and I'm serving in a statutorily defined position of somebody who has healthcare administration expertise. And there's other statutorily required kinds of expertise on that board too. So all those, we filled all of those. But because we have elected officials on this board now, and we have some people that used to serve in public office, like we have a former Secretary of Health and Human Services that was chosen to serve on the board. Her name is Carmen Hooker Odom. She served under the Governor Easley administration. So we know how to be transparent and serve in a public sort of way. And that's how, in our meeting on January the 6th, this is how we decided that we intend to move forward. Somebody pointed out at that meeting who was representing one of the CFAC, and she was one of the CFAC members, which is the Community and Family Advisory Committee, which is required by statute to serve, to provide input to the Cardinal governance, pointed out that minutes, for example, from previous meetings, when the board passed a motion that it wasn't revealed in the minutes who voted for or against. In fact, it didn't even show that there was any opposing votes. It just said that the motion passed. So that's not the kind of transparency and accountability that this board wants to see. So we want to make sure that meetings are going to be held, that people have easy access to attend. And so we haven't decided yet how that's going to work, if we're going to rotate around counties or just meet in a central county, or they could meet down in where we use that term, corporate headquarters, where the organization's headquarters is in Charlotte. But we just want to really, my point is that we want this organization to have as much community input as possible, and we want to be as transparent and accountable as possible not only to the counties and the boards of commissioners in each of the counties served, but to the clients that are being served as well. So that's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Mr. Lashley?
No, I'm okay. Don't have anything.
It's just great to see so much community support for stepping up, and I mean, a lot of familiar faces, and it's amazing how our county works.
It is amazing. And we have an amazing county employee here tonight with us who was recognized recently as the Soil and Water Technician for the state of North Carolina. So I want to call attention to Brad Moore and his accomplishments, and to thank him. That is an outstanding recognition, and Brad is an amazing person and works so hard, and I've been continually impressed by his creativity and his willingness just to do what it takes to get the job done. So a well-deserved award. And with that, we're adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.